welcome to the second service, and very warm welcome if you're visiting, let's just prepare our hearts for worship, and we're going to sing his praises, we're going to listen what God has to say through Ryan, but I'm going to read a verse that came to me this week, and this is a Psalm 46, and he says, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth." Also, I stumbled upon the short videos on YouTube, and I saw this guy roasting a Christian. It was just like a chat, but it just didn't sound very. And he was saying, he was asking basically, why is the guilty? Why, if this is a judge and there's a guilty, why does the judge sacrifice his own son for the guilty? And it was seemed like an excerpt from a long video, but he was asking a question. He wasn't really blaming the person. And I hope the guy answered that because the judge loves the guilty too. And that's kind of the message we are as a church in the Gospel of John. And just for a recap, we have done water turning into wine, we have done the raising of the temple in 3 days, and the Nicodemus story. And today we will be reading John 3, and from 14 to 21. And that would obviously cover a very, very popular verse, and that's probably for the kids when they break up and go into their Sunday school. It's all about God's love, and it's a different kind of love, isn't it? It's not just like we say love you, which actually means bye bye. It's a love that if you've got children, you know how much you love your children, or if you've had loving parents or have got loving parents, you would know what it is. And God's love is multiplied exponentially. And it's that kind of love. And thank you for coming for the second service. We'll be praying and then we'll be singing two songs. Let me just pray and then we'll be singing. Heavenly Father, we come to you again, Lord, and we just pray that you would still our hearts and, Lord, that we would just be open to what you have to say through your word. And Lord, open our vocal cords so we can sing loudly to you, Lord, and your praises. And Lord, remember our Christian brothers and sisters who can't do this, Lord, and in many countries, Lord, where Christians are being persecuted, Lord, countries in war, Lord, and so this is really a privilege, Lord, that we can come to you and sing your praises, Lord. Prepare our hearts to worship you in Jesus' name. Amen. So please write us the video.
Let's go ahead and stand and sing together. I can sing of your love forever.
Sing. Instead of light, because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. Let us pray. Father, we thank you because of this beautiful day that you have made for us to see, to rejoice, and to be glad in it. We thank you because of your love that you have extended to us, even though we don't deserve it, but you did love us and you made your Son to die for us. I thank you for the privilege of knowing you, O God. Well, Lord, we pray as men who have not come to know you, as they hear your word today, Lord, soften their hearts that this word will have an impact in their lives, O God. Lord, we pray, O God, that, you know, for the message that Ryan will bring the word, that he will speak of you, not of himself. And let this word have a place in our hearts, make us better than what we are, O God. Lord, we pray for a world that is filled with crisis at this time. So much hatred instead of love. Brothers killing brothers, and, you know, just neighbors just hating each other. But we ask, O God, that let your love permeate the hearts of every man, O God, so that we can stop the evil and, you know, the massacre of one another. You know, we pray for peace in our world, O God. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Go ahead and stand for one more song. What a friend we have in Jesus. And at the end of that song, the kids can go ahead and go out to their class. Okay? Stand and sing.
Thank you.
I know the last few weeks we've been covering the book of John, and we've already been seeing a lot of different things that are happening, from Jesus calling his disciples, turning the water into wine, all these different things. And now we get to, well, probably one of the most known verses, like Raj said. But one of the things that it talks about is very simply the word love. Now, in our society, in our culture today, we use the word love in a lot of different ways. Oh, I love going to that place. I love that food. I love it when we go to get to do this. But is that really what love is? I mean, can we really say that that's what it is? I remember when the boys were little, probably about 8 years ago, I wanted to do something for Sarah for Mother's Day, and I said, okay, I set them down, 8 years ago, Ryle would have been 10, and then 8, and then 6, and so just picture them at that age, and they ate a lot less, I figured out then. But I asked them, I said, how do you know Mom loves you? And they started giving me different things. She spent time with me. She reads me stories. She cuddles with me. And they give me all these different things. And then we printed out these things and put it all in this shadow box. That way Sarah could see a picture of her and the boys together and see all the things that they said. Well, what they didn't say was just because she said she loves me. Because love is something that can't just be something that is said. Love requires action. Love is a verb. Love requires actions to display what is being said and shared. Because let's face it, if someone says, oh, I love you, but their actions never back it up, do we believe that they love us? No. We'll question it, we'll doubt it. But when there's actions that back it up, that changes everything. And that's one of the things that we're going to look at today as we look at the passages from 14 to 21 of chapter 3, but it's understanding that there's going to be lots of different things that are seen because these actions of love are visible. And that's such an important thing, because when we see this, we'll understand it more. And when we understand it, we're able to see the love that God has for us. Now, it's interesting how when we look at John 3:16, it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Now, what I want us to see first is that first word there. It says for. Notice I underlined it there. Because what that word for means is that it connects to what has come before it. So we need to kind of look back and see what is said there, because obviously it wants to make this important connection from verses 14 all the way to 21, and we see how it all fits together. So let's look at that together. It says, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life in him. Now, if the Son of Man has to be lifted up, understand this. When we hear the word lifted up, there's not exactly a connotation like it would have had, an understanding that it would have had back then. See, because back then, they only would have used the words lifted up talking specifically about crucifixion. When we say someone has to be lifted up now, someone's going, okay, where's the ladder? Where's the stepping stool so we can lift them up? But understand, when it said lifted up here, they're declaring that this person had to be crucified. That the Son of Man had to be crucified. That everyone who believes in him may have eternal life in him. And because of that, we see that eternal life is not possible without Jesus. Jesus is the center point that everything around has to come to. And then because of this, we get verse 16, which once again, we see that demonstration of his love through the actions that he takes. Because verse 16 tells us that because he has to be lifted up in order for us to have eternal life, in order for us to be made right, that this action of love comes out of the necessity of sin. Sin is there and present, therefore something has to happen. And in an act of ultimate love, God sends his Son. And so we see this crown of thorn here, but what shape does that make on the Bible pages there? We see a heart there, don't we? It's out of the actions of love from God that we see the love of God. So once again, it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." It's through the giving of God's Son, Jesus, that we see the love that he has for more. And this is kind of like one of those, you know, those adverts where they say that they're going to give you something and then they say, wait, there's more. This is another thing in that verse. There's more. He does this. He gives this gift while we're still living in sin and death. He doesn't wait for us to sort ourselves out and then come to him. And then he says, okay, because now you fixed yourself, now I'll give you this gift of my Son. Understand this. When we were not deserving of a gift that he has given, he gives the ultimate gift of love, grace, and mercy for all of us. Now think about that. I don't know if you've ever had someone, I'm not going to call them an enemy, because then that sounds like really like comic bookish. But have we ever had somebody that was, you could tell, was actively doing things against you? Or maybe they were coming across and just seemed like their actions, they just didn't like you very much. In that moment, have you ever thought, you know what, I'd like to get them a gift? See, people laugh, why? Because it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense at all. If someone was against us, the last thing we're thinking is doing something kind and giving them a gift. If you have someone that is accusing you of doing things that you did not do, trying to run your reputation through the mud, the last thing you're going to think about is, you know what? I really should get them a heartfelt gift that's going to cost me something. Because understand this, when we look at what God gives, we have this second thing. First, it requires action, but then understanding that love is sacrificial. If we love someone, at some point, we will have to sacrifice something. Think about it. Sometimes when we love someone, we're going to have to do something that they want to do, and we don't want to do it, but we'll do it anyway. Love is sacrificial. Sometimes it's going to have more of a cost. But either way, there is a sacrifice involved with love. And we see this in God's gift of his Son in chapter 3, verse 16. We see this because he gives Jesus as a gift when we don't deserve it, when we are literally enemies with him because of the sin in our life. Someone may sit there and say, well, I don't like being called an enemy of God. I'm just telling you what Scripture says. It says that we are against him because of our sin. And in that, he says here, have this gift that changes everything. And by the way, you can't earn it. You don't deserve it. But I'll give it to you freely. Now, don't misunderstand this where we say, you know, give it to you freely. It wasn't free. It cost a very high price. But why does God do this? Why would he give a gift with such a high price? And see, a lot of times we read chapter 3, verse 16, but we don't keep going. And the beauty is all of these things fitting together. Yes, John 3, 16 is a wonderful, beautiful verse. Yeah, but we need to see what's after it too, to see what else is included in this. And so as we read it, it says, "For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son." Now, did you catch that? First, I want us to notice the word world, okay? And the reason I want to bring that up is because sometimes people are going, you know, who's he talking about? He's talking about a gift for everyone. A gift for all people, for all nations, for all languages, for all backgrounds. Because his desire is that everyone should come to know Jesus as their Savior. Condemnation was not the reason, because we were already condemned. Jesus did not come in to condemn us. Our sin has already condemned us before he ever arrived. It says in Romans 3:23 that we have all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Does anybody here think that they don't qualify in that all statement? I'm in it. All of us are in the same boat. When we're born, we are born into a sinful world. We have sin in our life. Our sin automatically condemns us. But Jesus says, I didn't come here to condemn you. I came here to save. Now let me ask you a question. If Jesus didn't come to condemn but to save, and then save through the sacrifice of his life, it says that he laid his life down and then he took it back up again. Does that sound like an act of condemnation? Or does that sound like a gift? That gift had a high price. Now, the instructions here are pretty easy to understand. We must believe in him, and then we're not condemned. Now, when I say believe, that doesn't just mean believe he was a person. It doesn't just mean believe he was a good teacher. It doesn't mean that it's just that he was just this nice guy. Because so many times I've met people that are like, well, I think he was a good teacher, but I don't believe that he was God's son. Let me ask you a question. Can a good teacher lie to you about the most core things that he is teaching and still be good? No. It's not possible. Can't say he's a good man if he wasn't who he says he is. A lot of times we find people where they'll try to say, well, he's a good teacher or a good moral person or different things like that. How can he be good or moral if what he is saying is a lie? It's not possible. So either he's the one person in history that we have to make a decision about. Either he is who he says he is, or he's a liar, or he's insane. Now I'll tell you this, in studying God's word, and looking at the prophecies and looking at what he fulfilled and all these different things, I am completely convinced that he is exactly who he says he is, and that is the Son of God. You may be sitting there going, you know, I'm not quite sure. That's fine. Let's sit down and talk. If you have questions, we can sit down and discuss it. But understand, we can't take this middle-of-the-road approach where we're like, well, you know, I like Jesus, but then reject what he says. And that is that we have a chance to accept or deny. There is no middle ground between the two. And when we do that, understand this, when we accept him, understand that then we experience that God's love is eternal. God's love is eternal, it's sacrificial, it required action. So God sent his son, who he loved and cared about, so that we can have an eternal life with him, all while we didn't deserve it. Now think about how amazing that is. He's given us a chance to be made right with him without having to earn it. Because guess what? There's no way we can ever balance our own scales. If we decided that we were going to set on our own rules and write them down, we would sit there and say, okay, I think this is right, this is right, this is right, this is right, okay. I guarantee you that by the end of the week, we would break our own rules on what we said was right and wrong. Why? Because we live in a fallen world. We constantly fight with this sinful nature that we have in our flesh. And so God says, hey, I'm giving you the answer to the question before you even knew there was a question. And I'm going to do it because I love you. Now, in verse 17, it points out once again that it is through him. It is only through him, through Jesus, that we can have this gift. In John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. He is declaring that there is but one way to eternal life. I've heard some people say, well, God is such a loving God. You know what? In the end, he couldn't condemn a lot of people. So, you know, he's just going to accept everybody and everybody's going to get to go to heaven at the end. If that was true, then he sent his son to die for no reason. What scripture says is very clear. And that is, we've all sinned, we've all fallen short, and we are in need of a Savior. Now, do we accept that Savior, or do we reject it? As I was going through the different commentaries this week, I came across this, and I thought it was really helpful. Because even after we accept Christ, sometimes we battle with certain things. It says, the curse of sin no longer remains on us. We're not condemned, and we cannot be condemned. If God has declared us innocent, who has the right to charge us with sin? Jesus, the one who paid our penalty, is now standing at God's right hand, and no one is able to tell God we still need to pay for our sin. Not a chance. Jesus paid it all. Nothing is left to pay. In John 3:18, the phrase "is not condemned" is in the present tense, which means our condemnation has already been removed. It doesn't just anticipate a final day when God removes the guilt from us and does not cast us into eternal punishment. It says right now, right here, you are free from condemnation. It is easy for a Christian to feel the weight of sin and guilt and condemn himself. When he does so, he forgets the power of the cross. Now I want you to think about that. I'll be honest with you, this is something that I have struggled with many times. And what I do when I do that is I take away the power of the cross and what Jesus did on the cross. And I take it back and try to sit there and say, well, no, I'll condemn myself. What I'm literally telling Jesus in that case is, you were not enough. And in those moments, let me tell you one thing, I am wrong. It should remind us that, yes, there is no condemnation once we've accepted Christ our Savior, but understand this, that we should live in the power and the strength that God gives us through that cross. That cross does not just signify death. That cross signifies the payment that was made, the complete payment, lacking nothing. And then we live in the power of the resurrection that we have in Jesus, that we celebrate on Easter morning. Because the same power that resurrected Christ from the dead is the same power that the Holy Spirit has and uses and works in our lives when we humble our hearts, go to him and say, Lord, I need you. And there's going to be different times and different phases and different seasons in our lives, and we will struggle with this at some times, and other times we will not. But let me tell you something. God's faithfulness does not change in a season or a moment. It is faithful, each and every step of the way, each and every moment. As we look at this passage, some may sit there and struggle and say, you know, words like condemnation and judgment, it makes it hard for me to see God as a loving God because of those words. But remember, God has already given the sacrifice. He's given the only way to be made right, which shows his love, his justice, and his mercy. He provided the required payment before we knew we needed it. Let me ask you a question. If God is a just God, could we be let off from punishment without a price being paid? The fact is that God, in his love, he's given us this gift. He's given us a gift that is sufficient to cover everything. But then we see in verse 19 why so many still struggle. And the true reason is this. It's because we love our way. We love our sin. We love the way we want to do things. And when we do that, we tell God, no, I know better. Has anybody ever had a time where they gave somebody advice not realizing that person was an expert in what they were trying to tell? I think it's always funny when situations come up. I've seen videos. I've been around people when it's happened to where literally people will be like, well, what you need to do is this. And the person has like a PhD in electrical engineering and they're talking about electric. So I'm going, And you just kind of sit back and you kind of snicker and you laugh and you're like, But we do that to God all the time. We sit there and say, Lord, what you should have done is this. And God's going, really? The fact is we have to realize that we have to submit our heart to God's way. See, in verses 19 and 21, we see why there is this struggle. And it says, this is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love the darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. So it's not a love or a justice problem, it's a sin problem. We're going to say, well, I don't like the word condemnation and judgment. That's because we feel uncomfortable in our sin. And light is exposing that. And our reaction is, I don't want to do that. I don't like that. I'm sure Jesus didn't like the cross. Yet he still laid his life down for us. In a case like this, it's not about us dictating to God when we will accept, what we will accept, or how we will accept. What it is us submitting our hearts and going, Lord, I accept what you have given, which is more than sufficient, that came at such high a price. Thank you for loving me. See, when we look at these verses, we need to remember that light that has come into the world is Jesus. He has come into the world, as it says here, and that is what has exposed the battles in our hearts. That sin in our hearts that we struggle with and we battle with. But remember, he doesn't just expose it for the sake of exposing it. He exposes it so that we come to him. So that's the difference between religion and relationship. Religion, if you do something wrong, you want to hide away. When we see someone who's been at church or something like that, and they mess up, and all of a sudden they disappear for a while. They've pulled themselves away. When what God says is, don't go away. Come to me. All you who are heavy laden, I will give you rest. It's through that relationship with Christ that we receive that love, that forgiveness, that rest. The question is, are we going to accept? Are we going to see the sacrifice that he has made, submit our hearts and say, okay, I'll stop trying to tell you to do it my way, God. I accept your way. You may be sitting there today and saying, you know what? I still have questions. Questions are fine. Nicodemus came, as Chris was talking about last week, and asked questions. It's okay. But give us a chance to sit down and go through God's word until we can see exactly what God says, the love with which he says it, and accept that gift that he has given through the cross. So if you have questions, come and talk to one of us. And we can sit down and we can discuss it. But don't keep trying to sit there and say, well, I'll take this bit and that bit, but I can't go all the way. See, with Jesus, it's one or the other. And the cool thing is, God's already said, it's free. Just accept that. Maybe you have trouble remembering that you're not condemned, but free because of the cross. You've accepted Christ as your Savior, but that constant battle of fighting that condemnation that we put on ourselves, where we remove the power of the cross in our heart because we just can't get past something. The wonderful thing is God gives us a church family that can walk through these journeys with us, and we can walk in these journeys together. And then remember that God says that He is faithful to complete the work that He has started in us. If we were honest, every one of us could wear one of those, you know, like when you go to the tube station or the train station, it says work in progress, you know, please excuse our dust. We should all have those t-shirts. Because God's looking at us going, yeah, we're still working. But He's going to complete it because He says He's going to complete it. And we're all in the same boat here. We're all dusty. We're all a work in progress. But even that is an act of love and grace that we see in Christ. Even when we mess up, He's not condemning us. He's saying, come, and I will give you rest. We have to remember that we have a loving Father, and He wants us to come to Him daily and receive His new mercies each day, like it says in Lamentations 3:22-23. Think about that. God has His mercies each morning, new mercies each morning for us. We just have to go to them. God's love shows the actions. God's love has been sacrificial. And God's love is eternal. The question is, are we going to accept it? And the second question is, are we going to rest and remain in it? And allow Him to work in us so that we can share the freedom that we have in the cross with others. The joy we have in the cross with others. The love that we have in the cross with others. Let's not let a cross just simply be a piece of jewelry that we wear, but something that signifies the change that we have because of Christ. Not because we deserve it, but because God is that great. Let's pray. Lord, we thank You. We praise You for Your love. Lord, we wouldn't really know what love is if You did not show us, first and foremost. Lord, we thank You that though we don't deserve it, Lord, You gave the gift freely. Lord, we thank You that when we mess up, we can come to You, not have to run away. We thank You that You're going to complete the work that You started in us. And Lord, when we mess up, You're there to pick us up, dust us off, remind us that we are free. Lord, we love You for that. We thank You for that. We are humbled by that. Lord, if there's anyone that's struggling with this decision or has questions, Lord, I pray that they would come and talk to us. Lord, I pray that they would let go of the battle and come to You. Lord, I thank You. I praise You. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and sing now the song that says, "We'll praise the name of the Lord our God." Let's pray. Let's sing. Savior of all.
In our thoughts and in our words. In Jesus' name. Amen.